Well, my husband, Roger, is a worship pastor. We started out in youth, and then we went youth and music, and then we went on to worship ministry. And the other night, we were discussing some of the challenges of worship ministry. And one of the challenges is the tendency of people to express rather vocally their musical preference when it comes to Sunday morning church service. It's going to get personal real fast, right? So almost everyone has a different view of what constitutes good music. And it's usually synonymous with the music they like. So we've heard a broad range of opinions on music in our churches. Everything from "that was the best worship set I have ever heard," meaning they proclaim a great like, right? They really enjoyed it. But we've even heard, and Marjorie told me to tell you, I'm not making this up. We've even heard, "I don't know what God you're worshiping up there." Proclaiming an extreme disgust over the kind of music that we had going on. It could be easy for us to become discouraged over trying to please everyone. And that's especially possible when the only kind of statements we tend to get are opinions of musical style. We don't typically hear things about the execution of the music or the balance of the musical instruments, the voices, or about the smoothness of the transitions between songs. These are things that are less based on opinion of an individual, and they're more based on the reality of the musical performance. They're objective. So what makes receiving the opinions difficult for us is this. What one person finds distasteful to their musical palate, another person will find pleasing to their musical palate. So in other words, while it may be true for one congregate that the music was awful, that very statement will be false for another congregate. Now we have the problem of having to choose which subjective truth to inform our musical choices. Further complicating the matter is that the congregant making the subjective statement seems to think they are making an objective statement, which is something like, "I don't like that kind of music, and therefore that kind of music is inappropriate for church." But this problem we encounter in worship ministry is not uncommon. Rather, I've encountered the exact same problem when having conversation on belief in God. The exact same problem. A person will make a subjective statement about Christianity or God, but will do so in a manner that bears the likeness of an objective statement. It looks like it's objective. I believe this confusion between subjectivity and objectivity can keep many people from truly considering the truth about God, from considering the gospel message. And I believe this confusion between subjectivity and objectivity bewilders Christians who want to discuss their belief in God, but they're worried about offending people. So when we are engaging with people in a society, we are engaging with people in a society in which subjectivity appears to be usurping the role of objectivity. Remember in the last session, I talked about Oxford Dictionary's word of the year, post-truth. And post-truth, again, means that we're living in circumstances where objective facts they're less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and subjective views. Okay. So in my experience, these post-truth circumstances are especially pronounced in our conversations on belief in God. As Christians, we're called to be lovers of the truth and to share that truth in love, so we need to develop an effective approach to engage those who relegate all religious belief over to subjectivity, their personal likes or dislikes or preferences. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to look at how Christians can more effectively discuss belief in God through taking some steps. We're going to look at discovering subjectivity, and we're going to learn the difference there between subjectivity and objectivity so you can sniff it out. Okay? Discover subjectivity, we're going to uncover truth, and then we'll apply logic, right? The world keeps telling us logic and reason, let's use it. So we're going to use it today. So first, we want to discover subjectivity. One of the main problems we have, one of the main reasons we have trouble discussing what we believe with people who disagree with us is that we can't tell the difference between a subjective statement and an objective statement. So this is one of the reasons we end up talking past each other, or people end up saying, you just don't understand. This is just one of the reasons that that happens. So let's look at this. Let's define subjectivity, and this will be on your paper. Let's define subjectivity. A subjective statement is about the subject or the person, but not necessarily about the object it references. So subjective statement, remember, subjective subject. It's about the person making the statement, the subject. So examples of a subjective statement would be, blue is the best color. Chocolate ice cream tastes better than vanilla. Those are subjective statements. Now here's what you need to know and keep in your mind when you're talking to people. This is very important, that's what the asterisk means. That a subjective statement can be true for one person and false for another. It can be true and false at the same time. Okay, if you've ever heard the slogan, true for you but not for me, it comes out of subjectivity. So a subjective statement can be true and false at the same time. That's really important. So with my example, it could be true for me that blue is the best color, but for you, you may say green is the best color. So my statement, blue is the best color, while it might be true for me, could be false for you. Okay? And that's absolutely the reality of the situation. It's false for you, true for me. Same statement. When I make a subjective statement, I really need to include an indicator that I'm doing so. I need to say something like, in my opinion. It is my preference, in my view, right? To alert people that this is my opinion, right? Because the problem is, in my color example, blue is the best color. I have not told you anything about blue, have I? Not a thing. I told you nothing about blue. I actually told you something about me. But I said it like it was an objective statement. I said, blue is the best color. Like it's a cold, hard fact about reality, didn't I? But really, I'm just telling you something about me. It's my preference, my opinion. So I'm talking about myself, my own preferences, desires, and opinions. I've discussed myself with you without telling you I was doing so. I've discussed myself with you without telling you I was doing so. But while that thing I discussed could really be true for me, it could be false for someone else. And therefore, what I've said, blue is the best color, doesn't necessarily doesn't necessarily match the reality of our universe. Okay? Subjective statements don't necessarily match reality. Right? Because I said something like, blue is the best color. We don't know. That doesn't have to match reality. Maybe it does. I don't know. Maybe it's God's favorite color. But it doesn't necessarily match the reality of the universe. That's another real important point. Just because I prefer something doesn't make it true about the universe in which we live. So a subjective statement is about the subject making it, can be true and false at the same time, and it doesn't necessarily match the way the universe really is. Okay, we need to contrast that with objective statements, with objective. And this should also be on your outline. So what is an objective statement? It's a statement that is either true or false, is either true or false, and cannot be both at the same time. So it's a statement that's either one or the other, and can't be both at the same time. So let me give you an example. If I say blue is the color between violet and green on the optical spectrum of visible light, that is either true or it's false. It can't be both. Right? One or the other. The ice cream in the cone is chocolate. apparently you have an ice cream cone. If it's chocolate in it, that's either true or false, but it can't be both, right? Objective statements, remember this as for our conversation with others as we go into our second point. Objective statements are either true or false, right? And can't be both at the same time. Because if my statement about the color blue could be both true and false, think about that. The color blue is between green and violet on the visible spectrum of light. If that can be both true and false, we have an absurdity, right? We've got an absurd, it's illogical. We can't know what blue is. Uh-oh, what else can't we know, right? That's a problem. That's why objective statements are either true or false and can't be both at the same time, because if they are, it leads to absurdities, and then it starts blowing up our knowledge of things. So keep in the back of your mind as well that objective statements, or you can write it down, objective statements are true, I'm going to say this right off my notes, whether or not anyone believes it. Objective statements are true whether or not anyone believes it, agrees with it, likes it, or even knows about it. Objective statements are true whether anyone believes it, agrees with it, likes it, or even knows about it. Sometimes people look at me and they're like, well, the even knows about it one. And I said, yeah, before we invented the telescope, did those stars and galaxies out there that we couldn't see, did they exist? And they said, yeah. I said, we just didn't know about them. It's not that when we invented the telescope, now all of a sudden they popped into existence, right? They were there and we didn't know about it because it was objectively true that they existed, that they're there. So objective truths don't have to be known by people, okay? They're true because they match, they're either true or false. They either match the universe or they don't, the reality of the universe. When I make an objective statement, I mean to say that this statement matches the way the universe really is and is not my opinion. Okay, when I make an objective statement, I'm saying this is the way the universe really is. It's not my opinion. So in my blue color example, I've told you something about the color blue. I didn't discuss myself with you or my preferences. I presented it as it is, a fact about reality. It's either true or false. All right, but it can't be true for one person and not for the other, because that leads us to absurdity. So a lack of understanding of this difference between subjectivity and objectivity can help, it can keep us from having effective communication, so we need to help others uncover truth. Now we're going to put these, we're going to start putting these into action in our conversation. In discussion on belief in God, we can become entangled in subjective statements and in subjective thinking on beliefs. And remember, if we get entangled in subjectivity with a person, subjective statements can be true for one person and false for another. So we got to find a way to get out of the subjectivity and into objective statements. So we need to recognize and acknowledge subjectivity. Then attempt to move our conversation over to objective statements. So to uncover truth, we're going to recognize subjective statements. Let's look at one. In my Living in Truth study on page 66, I've put in there that a person says to you, I put a quote from a person, you're just having dinner or whatever, and somebody says to you, Christianity is the worst religion. Right? It's the worst religion. Now, if you were to try to carry on a conversation without recognizing the subjectivity of that statement, you're not going to get very far. Right? The person making the claim actually referenced themselves. They left out the "in my opinion." Right? They left that part out. In my opinion, Christianity is the worst religion. Rather, they've stated Christianity is the worst religion as if it were an objective fact, as if it were reality about the universe. That's what they said. They presented it objectively, even though it's a subjective statement. But this statement could be true for one person and false for somebody else. Right? Somebody else might come along and say, Christianity is the best religion. So your statement is false for me. So we need to learn to recognize this problematic use of subjectivity. When subjectivity is utilized as if it were objective, you're going to have a logical problem. Because a subjective statement doesn't necessarily match the reality of what you're discussing, the object. It's only the reality of the individual person's desires, right? A subjective statement only matches the reality of their own desires, opinions, or preferences. So that's the hard part, because it does match the reality of their personal opinion, preferences, or desires. Right? When somebody says something like this, it does match their personal opinion reality. I call it POR, personal opinion reality. Therefore, when you begin to say the person is mistaken or incorrect, the person may take your words as a personal attack. Right? Because it's about them. You're attacking them now. You see how that moved there? Christianity is the worst religion. They're saying something about themselves. So if you start dismantling that, you're attacking them personally because they're talking about themselves, ladies. That's what they're doing. This is one reason I think people are offended by Christians giving the gospel message as truth. Because the offended one believes that any statement about religion is purely subjective to the individual. So they get offended because it feels like you're attacking them. So they might, think, keep your personal opinion reality to yourself. Further, a person can get their feelings hurt or become defensive if you begin to dismantle their personal opinion, right? We don't want a person to become defensive and protective of their emotional well-being. What we want to do in conversation is we want to free them up to consider something objective about Christianity. We've got to free them up from this, everything's mired in my view of the world. Free them up to consider something that's objectively true about Christianity, and any kind of objective statement, right? Get them out of this me-centeredness, this subjectivity. So that's what we're trying to do. And what a sticky situation we've got with this. This is really hard, ladies. I mean, this has infected our culture to the point we've been taught that the autonomy of the individual, the individual's own desires, are like the highest moral good. So you try telling them that their personal opinion is wrong, right? That's what we're saying. Oh, I said wrong, right. You start telling them that their personal opinion is wrong. Well, they've been taught to follow their heart. So you are a hater. You see how that moves there? Wow. Okay, so recognize the subjectivity, then acknowledge it. Acknowledge the subjectivity. That's where we're at. So we might say this. Here's a question you can ask to help alleviate this situation. Help me understand you correctly. So our person said Christianity is the worst religion. Help me understand you correctly. Are you saying that in your opinion, Christianity is the worst religion? Or are you saying something like, it's a provable fact that Christianity is the worst religion? So are you saying that, in your opinion, it's the worst religion? Or are you saying it's something like a provable fact that this is the worst religion? Help them see that. Now, this line of questioning may be confusing to them at first, because, like I said, our culture has become so individualistic that we oftentimes don't see any difference between subjectivity and objectivity. We might actually believe that our personal preferences, desires, and opinions are one and the same with reality, right? Are one and the same. So if a person prefers that God doesn't exist, she may equate that subjective thought with the objective thought that God does not exist, or that, considering whether or not God exists. I'm going to tell you that no one I have ever encountered has said it to me this way. Nobody has ever said, I do not prefer God to exist. Like, I don't prefer that God exists. No one's ever said that to me, right? I really wish they would. I really wish they would. Like, it's my preference that there is no God. Oh, okay. I gotcha. So let's start from there and see why that is, right? We can get the backstory on that. Because I've been there myself. I had a point, like I was saying in my testimony, that I really didn't like Christians at a certain point. And I was sort of done with church, but I realized that that was my personal preference. It was creating a bias in me against belief in God. So I had to come to the point of, okay, well, what do I know that's objectively true? I had to look for that because my subjective view was getting in the way. So I wish people would tell me, it's my preference God does not exist. However, people are just much more complex than that. They're not going to do that. I don't even know if they know that they're conflating the two. I don't even know that they know they're doing this anymore, right? The way that I find it out is I oftentimes get very negative or loaded language from people who don't believe in God. Okay? That's how I can kind of sniff out the subjectivity in there. If that, there's very loaded language or negative terms. So I'll give you an example. If somebody were to say, and I've seen things like this, why would anyone believe in such a brutal, genocidal, and warmongering God? Okay, listen for the subjectivity. Then acknowledge its presence. So I'm going to say, are you saying God doesn't exist because he's brutal, genocidal, and warmongering? Or are you saying that, in your opinion, a God that is brutal, genocidal, and warmongering shouldn't exist? Which one? Are you saying he doesn't exist because of these things you're presenting as objective facts, or are you saying he shouldn't exist because you don't think he should? That's your preference, right? You may have to explain that difference. So you can say, well, what if it's someone's opinion that a God that is brutal, genocidal, and warmongering should exist? What if somebody else prefers that kind of God? Right? You're saying basically, say, because it's true for you, but not for me, and that could be true and false at the same time. So somebody else might prefer that God exist. Then I would say, does that actually tell us anything about God's existence? Does it tell us anything? No, because we're just talking about what we prefer, right? We're just talking about our preference. And then I might say something like, this is why we have to stick to arguments about whether or not God exists rather than giving our opinions on the matter. That has been met with varying levels of, oh yeah, to hostility. Like, I have to point it out that this is kind of your opinion, but you're really not talking to me about whether or not God exists, and you're not giving me reasons why. Okay. So I have to point those things out. Now, I don't believe those things I just said about God are true. I don't believe those are true. But we need to know which path the person is on. Are they on the it's true that I don't like it path, or are they, I'm saying something that's true for all people in all times and all places? That's an objective truth. So which path are they on? If a person's mired in subjectivity, you're going to have to, well, you may have to, not in all cases, but you may have to break through that way of thinking before you can have any effective conversation about God. You might have to break through them being mired in subjectivity before you can have effective conversation. Again, we got to be careful here. Because we have to be attentive to crashing around in another human being's emotions like a bull in a china shop, right? We just go in there attempting to prove the truth of what we believe. We have to be respectful even of subjective statements while attempting to get to the objectivity on the matter. And that's because God has made us both emotional and rational beings, right? So we have to respect that person's emotions as well. But if a person's going to claim that God does not exist, that's an objective truth claim. And so I want to acknowledge the subjectivity, but move them over to discussing objectivity. And that's our third part here under uncover truth. So we recognize, to uncover truth, we're recognizing subjectivity, we're acknowledging subjectivity. Now we're moving them into objectivity. And this is where I think we can do them a lot of good. Acknowledge their opinion, move into objectivity. So acknowledge the value of their opinion by saying, I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. If I thought that about the Christian God, I'd probably feel the way you do. There's nothing wrong with acknowledging that. I hear what you're saying. I think, however, there may be some misconceptions here about God. There may be some misconceptions. Would you mind discussing them with me? That's where I want to go. Now, as soon as, if she says yes, yeah, okay, I'm going to. If she says no, I don't want to discuss that with you, then no. If she says yes, I'm going to move into asking her what she believes, right? Because she thinks Christianity is the worst religion, or maybe she thinks God is genocidal and warmongering. So I want to ask her about that. What do you mean by that? So it's going back to my why do you believe that study, where I give the questions, how to ask people questions about what they believe. So I want to know what she believes. I want to know where she's getting that from. How do you know that? And then I want to find out why she's committed to it. Why do you believe that? And that allows her to give a little bit of that subjective opinion in there as well, okay? So I want to find out what she believes, where she's getting that from. I want to find out why she believes it. Oh, ladies, this is so important. I keep hearing so many people say things like, I'm raising my kids apart from God, and instead I'm raising them with evidence and reason. Right? I hear things like that. And then I look and I keep reading, I hear it or I read it, and I keep going down and I see immediately they make an illogical statement, like they'll attack Christians, they'll name call, which is irrational. It's an error in reasoning. So the very people who are crying out to us, use logic, use evidence, use reason, they themselves are not holding themselves to that standard. And so we gotta help them use logic. We have to move them into objectivity. One of the reasons this is so important, I'm going to read to you a passage of scripture from the Apostle Paul. We've been using Paul a lot. We're going to use him some more. I like Paul. He's a good teacher. So 1 Corinthians 15, you've got this passage. The whole chapter is on the resurrection of Christ. Remember, as Christians, we base our belief on the resurrection of Christ. Right? So in this chapter, we've got Paul making a case for the resurrection of the dead. And we come up to chapter 15, verse 12, we see that there's a problem. Some people are proclaiming that there's no resurrection at all of the dead. Okay, some people are proclaiming that nobody is raised from the dead. And then he says in verse 14, he says, "And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. Or useless." I have the NIV up there. That your faith is, Christ has not been raised. Our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. That is an objective claim. Pure and simple. This is either true or not true. If Christ had, I love how honest he is. If he hasn't been raised, if it's not true, your faith is useless. Yes. Logic, right? If there's no risen Jesus from the dead, there's no reason to have faith in him. And Paul just puts it out there in the scripture, right? We're not hiding anything, world. Here it is. If Christ didn't raise from the dead, our preaching's in vain. And he goes a step further. If you'll read in verse 15, he doesn't just say like, well, here's the logical outworking of that. You're preaching is in vain. He says, we are even found to be misrepresenting God, or some of you say false testimony, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise. If it's true, the dead are not raised. This is all objective, right? He's not saying in my opinion, in my view, this is what I prefer. This is either true or it's false. And if it's false, Christians, you're going around giving false testimony about who? God. That's pretty bad, right? This is why I like who Paul is. He just lays it out there objectively. It's either true or false, but it can't be both. It can't be. It's not true for me and not for you. This isn't what I prefer and just not what other people in the world prefer. He's either risen from the dead or he's not. And that's what matches the reality of the universe. Right. I love this. He does, again, I'm not going to read the passage, but if you want to mark it down. Oh, by the way, I don't want to leave you right there. Verse 20 comes back and says, but in fact, Christ has raised from the dead. He's the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Another objective claim that's either true or false. He did rise from the dead. And in fact, he's the example of everybody who will rise from the dead. That's either true or false. All right, and then again, Paul in Acts 26, Luke's reporting Paul's defense of the resurrection before King Agrippa. And he's starting in verse 24, it tells us that he was saying he was talking about the resurrection and the whole path about Jesus, his testimony, and he was saying these things in his defense. Festus said with a loud voice, "Paul, you are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind." But Paul says to him, "I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus." Look what he says. I'm using ESV. "But I am speaking true and rational words." I'm using logic with you. Wow. Right there. True and rational words. And then he's so bold because he believes his objective claim is true. He says, "And the king knows about these things, and I speak to him boldly. For I am persuaded that none of these things have escaped his notice, for this has not been done in a corner." In other words, the king himself knows that this has been done. He can verify it, right? He can tell us whether it's true or false. This is a whole lot of objective claims going on here, and it's right there in the scripture. So I think it's important that we see that we understand that the Christian belief in God is not mired in subjectivity, not even in our own scriptures. Paul's saying it's either true or false, but it's not true for me and not for you. It's not something I prefer. This is the way it is. And you've got it right there. So after we discover the subjectivity, we learn the difference between subjectivity and objectivity, and then we uncover the truth with people, we acknowledge or we recognize their subjectivity, we acknowledge the subjectivity and move them into objectivity. We've got one more step to take, and that's to apply logic along with Paul here. We're gonna apply logic. Now on your paper, you have a definition of logic, that it is a proper or reasonable way of thinking about or understanding something. It's the science that studies the formal processes in thinking and reasoning. So we've stopped teaching logic in the public schools, and I'm so sad about that because I tell my students at college, I teach a logic class at Houston Baptist University, and I say, hey, if we're not teaching you logic, if we're not teaching you how to think, what are we teaching you? And they all say that, what to think. You're teaching us what to think. I'm like, right, that's why you need logic. It teaches you how to organize your thoughts so that you can discover truth. That's what logic is for. If I don't want you to have truth, I don't teach you logic. I'm just gonna teach you what I want to be true, right? So logic is concerned with what is true and how we know whether something is true. Because of our society's tendency to relegate all statements about belief in God to a statement of subjectivity, we have become very confused, and there's a bunch of illogical sentiments running about. So we'll look at a couple of them, and we'll apply our knowledge to these. All right, so the first one that is running about our culture is all religions teach the same thing. Right? All religions, I've heard this one recently. Well, think about that. If all of our statements about God are subjective to the individual and their views and preferences, then I can understand why people say this, why they think this is true. Because that would mean that one statement about God, like Jesus is God, is absolutely true for one person, but it's false for another person. Absolutely false for the other person. Remember, subjective statements are true and false at the same time. So if what we believe about God is all subjective, then it could be true for one person and false for another, and that's the way it is. That's how you come up with something like this. In this way of thinking, Jesus is God and Jesus is not God would both be true. They're equally true for whoever believes them. It's going to be true for you and not for me, but maybe it's true for you and maybe it's false for you. But I mean, they're all equally the same truth. However, if Jesus is God and Jesus is not God are both true, what you end up with is no truth at all. Right? This sentiment would lead to no truth at all as far as religious beliefs. Because if everything's true, that's the same thing as nothing being true. Why? Truth implies falsehood. So in order for Jesus is God to be true, you have to have Jesus is not God would have to be false. But if it's subjective, you lose the ability to say one's true and one's false. So thinking both statements are true, like Jesus is God and Jesus is not God, spirals us downward into the obscurity of subjectivism. We just can't get anywhere with the person we're talking to. But there's hope, ladies, because there's the laws of logic. Right? Remember, God gave you a mind to be able to know him? He also gave that mind an organization of thoughts, logic. And there are some laws that govern this. And one of the laws that govern it is the law of non-contradiction. The law of non-contradiction says a thing is either X or not X. It can't be both at the same time. Okay, the law of non-contradiction is so important for our conversations with people who think all religions teach the same thing. Okay, you're going to find that this applies to Jesus is God or Jesus is not God, but they can't both be true at the same time. It would violate the law of non-contradiction. And you might say, who cares if we violate laws of logic? Then we can't know anything at all. So for my purpose, the area that I'm in, where we're down in the NASA community, okay, Jesus can be God for one person and Jesus is not God for another person. It's absurdity, whatever. Violates a law of logic. Who cares? Okay, well, what if I were to say, well, you can either study physics and engineering and send the astronauts up to the International Space Station in a way that would truly keep them from getting harmed, or we can build rockets out of marshmallows and gumdrops and light it on fire and see how it goes. Because both are true. A rocket will get them to the ISS. A rocket will not get them to the ISS. Both are true. You see what that does? People make these kind of claims about Jesus all the time. Well, Jesus is God is true for you, but not for me. Whoa, what? I made an objective claim. It's either true or false. It can't be true for one person and not for another person. You're violating a law of logic. Right? And I haven't said something that's in my opinion. See, now here's how people get around this. Some people in our society have found a way around this law of logic by saying all statements of religion are of the subjective nature. They're all purely subjective. It's just what you want to be true. Well, number one, from my personal experience, I did not want it to be true. And if you really study Christianity, you really take some time in Job, you really take some time with Jeremiah, I'm not sure you'd come out saying, wow, I really want this to be true. Well, this makes me feel good, right? This is just wish fulfillment on my part. Because there are some harsh realities in there about what it means to live in a fallen world. They're harsh. They're not warm fuzzies, right? So here's the problem. Here's another problem with this. If you take everything that's of a religious nature, like does God exist, and you throw it into the purely subjective realm, I think you're going to lose too much. You're giving up more than you know. Because in the end, that statement is not just religious, it's also philosophical. Right? It's does God exist is a question of philosophy. If you say all questions of a religious nature are also subjective, you're throwing philosophy in there too. Philosophy is how we study how we know things. So what goes along with that? Science is a way to know truth. That's a philosophical statement. I would be trashing that as well. How about the pursuit of science is a good thing? Well, there's a philosophical statement. Trash that as well. Can't know that either. Reporting the truth in scientific fields is just or is good. Philosophical statement out the window. So you can lie on all your data to get your grant for your field of research. Do you see what you lose? You begin to lose the ability to know anything at all and to make judgments. And we've just let this happen in our culture. We just let people say, well, that's true for you, but not for me. We need to hold them accountable. This is why they can't see the goodness of the gospel, why they can't see the truth of the gospel. They're just saying it's true for you, but not for me, but they don't take it out to its logical end. There's a great book, by the way, that takes all of these kind of arguments that the new atheists are making, and it takes them and it sends them all the way to their logical end, and you get to see how absurd they end up being. It's called The Atheist Who Didn't Exist by Andy Bannister. He's one of the Ravi Zacharias Ministries team members. The Atheist Who Didn't Exist, and I think the subtitle is like, or the terrible consequences of really bad arguments. I read that in a night. I couldn't put it down. He's hilarious. This is why the law of non-contradiction is so important. It helps us to know things. And here's another thing. Christianity does not teach such ill regard for logic. Right? We uphold the laws of logic. Christianity lines up with the laws of logic, such as the law of non-contradiction, in saying either Jesus rose from the dead or he didn't. But if he didn't, thank you, Paul, then your faith is useless. Logical outworking. That's a logical argument. Go, Paul, and his teaching, right? The scripture actually upholds this because God's the giver of rationality, right? So if you think all religions are the same thing, you'll have a hard time talking to people. If you think all religions teach the same thing, you're really going to have a hard time talking to people about belief in God. And you may have no idea of the ultimate repercussions of this kind of slogan. One more slogan. Let's apply our knowledge to, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. Right? Once again, this statement relies on the belief that all statements of religion are of a subjective nature. And it's going to run into the same problem with Jesus as God and Jesus is not God. Because a person can sincerely hold to one or the other, but that doesn't mean that their belief has any objective truth. Okay? They can hold to one or the other, but it doesn't mean it matches the way the world really is. For example, when my oncologist told me I had precancerous material in my body and it had to be removed, I could have sincerely believed that this wasn't so. However, my sincere belief would not have matched with reality, right? So the result of my sincere belief would have been sincerely dreadful. So sincerity about beliefs is actually, it's a good thing, but it is not the litmus test for whether or not something is true. And right, you can have sincerely dreadful results because of holding to sincerity of your belief. Well, I really believe this. Well, you may be wrong. Right, you may be wrong. Plus, this whole idea of sincerity, as I've said, can keep people from searching for what is true. Especially when the search entails some uncomfortable truth searching. In which the truth doesn't match what we want to be true. Because sometimes the truth doesn't follow our hearts. A lot of the times. Which is what makes truth a harsh reality at times. Let me share this scripture with you from Hebrews 4:12. And I think this is why a lot of people actually have trouble with Christianity. And that is that the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Right? The word of God is harsh truth. There's a good side to it, and it's an ultimate good as well. But the Word of God is not there to fit with our desires. And that makes it hard for us to move it out of the realm of subjectivity and into objectivity. So in review, what did we look at? We learned that to listen for the subjectivity in conversations, we have to discover that subjectivity. We got to know what it is and how it differs from objectivity. Then we uncover the truth by recognizing the subjectivity in our conversations, then acknowledging it and moving us over to objectivity, and then finally applying logic. Ladies, discovering the difference between subjectivity and objectivity can be a harder endeavor than it sounded in this presentation. It may have sounded hard in the presentation, but it's still going to be hard when you try to do this out in the world. But let me tell you, it's a long philosophy, this idea that all beliefs about God are subjective. It has a long philosophical history that has influenced Western civilization, that all religious beliefs are subjective and have no objective truth to be discovered. And let me tell you right now, that long history will not go down without a long fight. It's not going down without a long fight. And further complicating the matter is that it's in the church. We think our desire matches the truth of God, or that God wants what we desire all the time. You know, like we're trying to make it fit. Or we're trying to bring in the subjective views of the world and like I said, my first session, squeeze that somehow into what God has to say. I've encountered young Christian students, even students studying to be pastors, who have told me they are uncomfortable with discussing their beliefs with people of other cultures, and their reasoning was what's true for us may not be about God may not be true for those people. These are people studying to be pastors. Who say those people have their own traditions, their own truth, and who are we to tell them what to believe? Right? This is in the church. So we need to hold ourselves accountable for this. You know, as I mentioned earlier, I was giving you a cute anecdote about my husband and I in the worship ministry. Oh, we're a peach, right? You've got a worship minister has a wife that teaches logic. I actually tell people, if I don't have anything subjective to say about the music that's nice, I just don't say anything subjective at all. That's my mantra now. But as I mentioned, we experience this in the worship ministry. So it's there. It's in us. That's why we have to be lovers of the truth. That's why we have to admit we are often wrong because we're not King Jesus, the King of Truth. So we need to train up our Christians to understand the difference between subjectivity, objectivity, and thoughtfully engage with it, because God has made us that emotional and rational creature. Such training is going to go a long way in helping Christians to engage in the conversation on the truth about God and objective truth about God. Right? And it will also help to minister to those with whom we're having conversation on belief in God by freeing them up to consider the objective truth about God. And who knows, ladies, maybe it will even bring revolution to the worship ministry. Roger and I can only hope. Thank you very much.